one-tenth of your talk because I was so mesmerized I didn't want to hang the phone up. So Bob Atkins, come on up, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. Probably can't show the video without potentially incriminating myself, but that's the sound of a Piper Cherokee 180 going by at 167 miles an hour, straight level, with a water cooled Lycoming 360 in it, carbureted, making about 180, maybe 183 horsepower. Three blade constant speed prop, and that is our test aircraft. And I'll show you what that looks like here in a minute as I progress into the 1997. I got this idea that airplane engines were pretty archaic and they needed a little bit of help. There's not a lot of tech in the world that has stayed as stagnant as the internal combustion engine that we fly behind. Originally, most of its design was conceived back in the 40s when Pratt & Whitney was making round engines. And when the military came along and they said, you know, we need a smaller airplane engine for the forward scout aircraft out in Korea and Vietnam. And they come up with this great idea with military money, of course, defense budget. They said, well, let's miniaturize that Pratt & Whitney, make it flat, and, you know, that should work. So what we fly behind is military hardware. It was designed for war effort. It was designed to be able to sustain being shot at and keep running. And if there's one thing the British figured out, kind of the hard way, in World War II, and we also kind of figured it out too, is water cooling has one significant drawback for war aircraft. All it takes is a piece of shrapnel or ground fire in the wrong spot, and that airplane is disabled. Well, unless I'm wrong, we don't get shot at anymore. So it's kind of strange that we're still flying behind an engine that was designed for that purpose. And its design lifespan was roughly 500 hours. The fact that we get a couple of thousand out of them is impressive as, you know, manufacturers trying to push things a little bit more forward. This is what a liquid-cooled 540 cube Lycoming engine can look like. It's actually a real engine. It was really bolted together, and if we had hooked it up and started it up, it would have run. So the purpose of my presentation is to try and help everyone understand the benefits of having a water-cooled engine in your airplane instead of an air-cooled one. Because the usual concern is, oh, what if it springs a leak? How many of you in this room drove here with an air-cooled engine in your car? How many of you have actually had an air-cooled engine in a motor vehicle? Cool. Motorcycles mostly. How many VWs?
Poor man.
Yay, all right. Crowds here. But those engines are long gone. Can anybody tell me why?
Noise.
Noise not the problem. Well, there's that. But more technically, does anyone know why the air-cooled engines have vanished in almost everything with wheels on it? That includes motorcycles. Efficiency is one of them. Uneven heating is the other one. Pollution is a little bit of the problem, but that's not as much as you might think. A significant element of why all air-cooled engines have vanished is because we no longer have lead in automotive fuel. So when the lead went away from automotive fuel, the exhaust valves in air-cooled engines and receipts run very hot. In automotive engines in the 5 to 600 degree Fahrenheit range. And can anyone guess what they are in our engines? The temperatures of the exhaust valve and seat? Not quite so hot, but in the vicinity of between 900 and 1,000 degrees is about the surface temperature. If you actually look at an air-cooled engine on a dyno running, the exhaust side of the cylinder is glowing slightly red. That's what your engine looks like under the cowl when you're boogieing along in your airplane. And the interesting thing about that is that the only thing keeping the exhaust valve from hammering the exhaust seat to death is the tetraethyl lead buffer that forms between the valve face and the valve seat, making it a dissimilar metal and minimizing, you know, basically the molecular diffusion that will occur and the micro spot welding that can occur between the two surfaces, because they're like metals and they're running very, very hot. And at those temperatures, what we like to call a hardened valve seat is mush. It's not hard at 900 degrees. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't take much. So mostly, air-cooled engines went away because of no lead in the fuel. And the manufacturers knew they're going to have a lot of trouble with the valves, particularly exhaust valves. And I'll get into that a little bit more. So some of the other benefits are bringing the cylinder head temperature down. In an air-cooled engine, we typically look at the head temperature and we go, oh, 350 to 425, and we consider that fairly normal. We run 100 octane ab gas in there. In a water-cooled engine, the head temperatures are typically 200 degrees or less. Interior combustion chamber temperatures are typically 300 to 350 degrees. I'm talking surface temperatures here. Air-cooled cylinders, basically, when you heat the head up, you might as well be taking octane away. You've got a suppressed detonation. When you compress an air mass, it heats up. You compress that air mass against the walls of a chamber and a piston and everything else that's very hot, you're transferring a lot of heat that's already, it's already getting hot on its own, and you're transferring a lot more heat into that fuel-air mixture as you're compressing it. That means we've got to have low compression. Low compression, 8 to 1. Now, actually in the airplane business, low compression is, well, 7 to 1, even less, but you know, 8 to 1, oh, that's considered high compression, or is it 8.5? So more power is the result of it being able to have higher compression. Does anyone have any idea what the typical compression ratio is in today's automobiles? The four bangers, the six bangers, any guess?
10 to 1.
What octane gas do they run on?
87,
and they love it. So that should give you an idea. When technology moves forward from the 1940s to roughly the 1980s, because actually the stuff we're driving on was developed back in the 80s, and it's just taking that long to finally make it into the production market. Simplify engine operation simply because, hey, no more temperature management, gone. Reliability and lifespan, when you're lowering the temperature of the chamber, the cylinder, and everything else, the metals stay harder, they wear less, you don't have any issues with work hardening the aluminum and thermal stresses. You get to improve your fuel economy because you can now run a stoichiometric mixture. You can also run it ultra lean if you want to, and you don't have to worry about detonation. I can't stress that enough. Most air-cooled engines are calibrated to run quite rich. Lycoming specification for the O360 is 14.7 gallons an hour in a test cell at maximum, you know, wide open throttle at 2700 RPM. I have yet to see a production aircraft, you know, delivering less than about 16 gallons an hour to the same engine in a installation, a standard production installation. And I have seen the fuel flows as high as 19 gallons an hour on O360s, yes, O360s at wide open throttle with either a carb or fuel injection. Does it mean it's right? No, obviously that's a little too rich, but why did it get that way? I couldn't give you an answer, but 16 gallons an hour wide open throttle is not unusual. Reduce cooling drag, and we'll get into that a little bit more, but basically those two really nice holes in the front of your cowling that let air into the engine compartment, well, the air that doesn't go through that hole spills around that hole. The best way to visualize this would be to take an ice tray. I like to use an ice tray because it's got the right little shape there. Put it under a stream of water about a foot above it from your tap and watch what happens to the liquid as it hits that ice cube and spills out around it. It's a beautiful shape to look at. You can visualize what is happening to the airstream around the intake holes to your engine compartment. One of the things that really hurts air-cooled installations is that a lot of that air, that turbulence, spills over the top and the sides of the aircraft, and that's the low pressure side of the aircraft. you have immediate airflow separation from the nose of your airplane going back, and we all know that's bad. That contributes to parasitic drag. So you don't want to have airflow separation from the nose of your airplane, either on the sides or above, if you can avoid it at all. So, you know, there's that problem. The other problem is air-cooled engines need a lot of air pressure to cool them down. Now, in cooling terms, we don't use inches of mercury, we tend to use inches of water. It's a more granular scale, all right? And it's the same concept as, you know, you've got a tube of a column of water, and how much the water displaces based on pressure is inches of water. So Lycoming specifies for the O360 a minimum of 7 inches of water pressure, or 7 inches of air pressure, I should say, using H2O, to jam enough air through the engine. And this is the minimum requirement to keep it from melting down. Most of our aircraft and the production installations, because I've instrumented a few, at approximately 140 to 150 miles an hour airspeed, are generating close to 10 inches of water of air pressure in the engine compartment, across the engine, in order to push enough air through the engine. Now, that's probably more than necessary, but we talk about drag and cooling drag, and this is something that when we started the project, it was like, our goal is to water cool the engine and make it run efficiently, but then we realized when we started flying it, the gains were pretty dramatic. So the best way to describe cooling drag is take a large pipe, put it in a wind tunnel, like a culvert or something, you know, like a big, you know, 12-inch piece of pipe, put it in a wind tunnel, in line with the airflow in the wind tunnel, okay? Now, put a blockage in that pipe, what's going to happen? You put a blockage in the pipe, and you build the air pressure in the pipe up to about 10 inches of water, what do you think is going to happen to the drag on that pipe? It's going to be like pushed out the other side of the wind tunnel. That's exactly what's going on with our cooling systems with air-cooled engines. The gross reality is you lose about 10% of your mechanical horsepower just to keep your air-cooled engine cool. Got 180 horse, you need 18 horsepower just to keep it from melting. That's a lot of horsepower loss in drag. You're losing it in drag. So if you can reduce the drag of air through the cooling system, you're reducing drag on the aircraft, and we all know the benefits of that, all right? So one of the reasons the Cherokee goes 173 miles an hour top speed, this is 2 miles an hour over VNE in level flight at 1,000 feet MSL on a standard day out here. Has anyone known a Hershey Bar Cherokee fixed gear to go that fast? Mm-hmm. With about 180 horse in it?
No.
Not straight level. And I might add, it also outflies an aerofoil, both in climb and forward speed in level flight. I actually have video to show if anyone's interested later. Lower octane unleaded fuels, we all know the story with avgas. Whether we like it or not, leaded avgas is going to go away someday, whether it gets sued out of existence, or as the old saying goes, we're one explosion away from unleaded fuel, because there's one place in England that makes tetraethyl lead, apparently nowhere else. So if that production of that stops, we're going to have unleaded fuel. And another reason for liquid cooling is advanced engine management systems. Now, I'm pretty sure everyone in this room has had, or may still have, a vehicle with a carburetor on it. But for those persons that are under the age of, say, 30, they don't know what a carburetor is. In fact, they probably haven't lifted the hood of their car, and if they have, all they saw was plastic, which is what mostly is under there these days. The fact of the matter is that the simplicity of using a carburetor, a manual mixture control, all that is all well and good, but we need to move beyond that, and there's many good reasons for it. So the interesting thing that happened in this project, and you can see even Harley Davidson got the message years ago, they decided to go water cooled on their motorcycle. Okay, they still make the air cooled ones. The world wouldn't be right without them, but they've also, you know, come to face the fact that water cooling their engines does make them last longer and give a whole lot more power. Why convert an existing engine? Oh God, this is so important. There's about a quarter million aircraft flying in the United States, and I don't think all of them have piston engines, but safely say that probably 180,000 of them do. There's approximately 3,000, maybe 4,000 new piston aircraft that enter the fleet every year, all flying the same basic engines that are in the existing fleet. And the problem here is that if a new engine were introduced, and the French have tried it with their diesel, Porsche tried it a few years ago with their motor. The Porsche motor, does anyone know why it got withdrawn? Why Uni gave up on it? It's a good little motor. Okay, it was air-cooled and everything, but it was still a good little motor. The problem is that the FAA requires mechanics to be properly trained before they work on something and or have all the necessary manuals. Well, nobody got training on that motor because there was only a few dozen of them flying around. The mechanics, they've got to earn a living. They're not going to go out there and invest a bunch of time and money and everything in the possibility that they might work on one of these Porsche Mooneys if they show up. So Porsche had to support the engines in the field. They also learned a hard lesson. No, you can't send the guy from the Porsche dealership over to fix an airplane. It's got to be an A&P.
Was that really their idea?
Yes. Initially, at their deployment, they thought they'd be able to just send the local mechanic out to work on it. But suffice it to say, that didn't work out so well. And the problem with it then became is that Porsche ended up, not that they had an unreliable product, their product was actually very reliable, but things go wrong. It may have nothing to do with the engine. The poor guy can't get it started. Maybe there's a clogged filter. Who knows what the issues were. But we all fly to out-of-the-way places where there's usually not commercial service. So if your airplane breaks down, Porsche had to fly a mechanic all the way to wherever you happen to be in the middle of nowhere. And it started getting expensive. So that's one of the reasons why they gave up on it. They couldn't penetrate the market with enough engines to gain some form of critical mass. And this is so important as to why we decided to do an existing engine. First of all, that's the only way there's even a hope in hell of penetrating the general aviation market and doing it. The second aspect of it is that it's a proven engine. Really nothing wrong with the Lycomings and the Continentals, at least from the bottom standpoint. They're built to take the punishment of driving a propeller in an airplane. Their weak spot is the combustion chambers and the cylinders. So we felt we could change that. So we really felt that we could modify an existing engine, minimize the possibilities of having to do a full recertification, get an STC. Our original plan was not to change any internal components. And to that end, this is Rev 1 of our water pump. You might go, oh my God, is that thing huge? And you'd be right. Well, that's because this part is our water pump, and that part's the Lycoming part. This is a governor adapter for a Lycoming engine that's running a governor on the back lower left pad of the engine. And so we thought, well, we don't want to penetrate the engine. We'll use a standard Lycoming part, and we'll just mount to it. And by the way, the FAA considers these type of things to be accessories. This is an accessory to the engine. It's not an interior internal part. So it can be treated as an accessory and different certification requirements like that. Suffice to say, we learned some lessons with that bad idea. Didn't really buy us anything, so we made a smaller one. This one. And before you wonder, well, that's cut off about almost 4 inches of it. The other thing to keep in mind is this part is inside the engine. So the actual part that's sticking out of the engine is here. And whatever cover happens to go on the back of it, which is something like this. If I drop this all on the ground, I'll be doing well. So that's kind of what the whole pump assembly would look like hanging off the back of the engine. Quite a bit of it's quite compact, and it does fit quite well in most aircraft. Made a smaller pump, a six-cylinder pump, with a six-cylinder engine. That's this pump. Amazingly enough, stops right there. That's the whole pump. In my hand, this part just sticks inside the engine. Yes?
Sir, the pump, does that come out off the backside engine, or is it the governor, I think,
spin area for the governors. So that's why I'm really confused.
It does. On the 360 and the 540, we use the lower right pad looking from the back of the engine to drive the pump. So some 360s that run constant speed props have a governor back there. If you've got an Arrow or certainly other models, they put a governor back there and you're going to say, oops, well, that's not going to work. I still want my constant speed prop, and I agree with you. There's the C1 C6 engine that's running the Senecas. There's the F1 A6 series engine that both have the governor pad where it belongs, up front on the left side in front of number two cylinder. So yes, if this were to ever come to fruition where we got it certified, you'd have to change the actual engine case in an Arrow or a similar aircraft that has a rear-mounted governor, because our pump needs to go where the governor is. I might add, given the various little problems that have happened with that pressure line that comes up from the governor going up to the front, cracks and stuff, and there's ADs on that, I think everyone would be happier putting the governor in the front so that you don't have that kind of problem.
Why not use the pressure pump?
Why not use what pressure pump?
The pressure pump adapter. Nobody uses vacuum. Well, a lot of people are switching over to electronics instrument. They don't need the vacuum pump anymore. So.
That's true, but unfortunately the size of our pump, as you can see, is not insignificant. Okay. It just won't fit up the top and clear the engine mount and everything else that's up there. So that's one of the reasons why we didn't do it. Another reason we didn't want to mess around with an automotive conversion or anything like that. This part here, guys, really important. No propeller speed reduction unit, no gearbox, no nothing. Direct drive, really good. And there's some really good reasons for that torsional vibration, for anybody who's been playing around with engines and propellers. Compatible with existing airframes, fuel maintenance facilities and parts suppliers, a lot of in common stuff by doing an engine. Here's a better picture of the 540. I love that picture. I don't have as good a picture of the 360, so that's why the 540 is up there. And there's a picture of the Cherokee 180. Does anyone know what the GRF stands for?
Goes really fast.
Yeah, that's it. Tongue in cheek there, but yes, that's why we did it. See that cowling? Yeah. That cowling there and that intake scoop is a completely new cowling. This is not the original cowling changed. That is actually a cowling that's made out of carbon fiber. It's our first cut, I might add. We sort of guesstimated it. I went through hell making that because I didn't know a lot of you fellows, that some of you guys are really geniuses with composites, but I unfortunately couldn't find somebody like that when I was doing this. So that's a $80,000 cowling there. And it's a long story, so I won't get into it, but just suffice it to say, boy, did I go down the garden path with, you know, to try and get that made. Finally, by the way, it was made by Stan Walisky of Benchmark Composites, if any of you know him. But all the money was lost well before Stan got into the picture. He came and rescued me. So one intake scoop here, and those of you who've got a keen eye might see a little tiny scoop there below the propeller. And we'll get a better look at it later in the show. The main scoop is cooling air for the radiator and induction air for the engine. And cooling air is also for both water and oil, so single scoop. One thing I'd like to point out, you know, there's a design element of this from the side. You can see where its boundary layer separated from the cowling, and it's also cut at an angle. It's not a straight scoop, it's cut at about a 40-odd degree angle. I spent some time looking at the old NACA data on the P-51, trying to understand their wind tunnel data, which, by the way, is freely available on the net. And I learned a valuable lesson about what they learned. You need to keep the scoop away from the boundary layer of the aircraft, or you're going to get a lot of turbulence around the upper intake lip, because you've just got turbulent air starting to go past it, so you want that scoop in clear air. All right? Second thing you want, spillover. You want to control where the spillover goes, because not all the air is going to go through the scoop. Going to have air spilling over, you want to spill it over where it does the least amount of harm. And where it does the least amount of harm in one of these aircraft, and most, I might add, is have it spill over underneath. Because a couple of feet behind there is the exit air from the engine. And underneath the belly of the airplane, it's plenty dirty already. Adding a little more to that doesn't do anything nasty to the overall parasitic drag of the aircraft. So one of the reasons this 180 horsepower aircraft picked up 15 to 16 miles an hour in airspeed is simply drag reduction. I can't emphasize that enough. But in addition to drag reduction, and yes, you'll say, well, the cross-speed prop help. This airplane, those of you who have owned one or flown one will know that with one pilot on board, which is the way I have to do this because it's experimental, very quickly, amateur-built experimental, and this, two different things. Amateur-built, you can fly it around once you've done your hours and everything, you're not really restricted. This experimental is a red certificate the FAA will give you to strap a JATO rocket to a lawn chair and go fly it. They don't care, but they give you really tight restrictions. Where you can fly it, who you can put in it, and everything else. So this is R&D experimental. I just don't have the R&D in front of there. It has to be renewed with the FAA every 2 years maximum. All right. I'm only allowed to fly a single pilot or at most having a flight engineer on board for the purpose of reading instrumentation and keeping track of engineering data. So Cherokee 180, on a good day, air-cooled utility category, which is full fuel and my well-fed butt in the seat, will climb out at about 900 feet a minute on a good day, right? In this configuration, 1,500 feet a minute is a no-brainer, and that is at 110 miles an hour. I'm not exactly pushing it, all right? It will maintain 1,500 feet all the way up to 4,500 feet without even breaking a sweat. And I know this because when you climb out of Compton and you want to go over LAX, you have to be at 4,500 feet to go across the corridor. And it used to be I had to do a couple of rotations to do that. Now I just climb up and hang a right. So that's the difference in performance. It's huge. Now, the constant speed prop adds a little. I'm not going to tell you that it doesn't. The constant speed prop, we know, added right around 250 feet of that. So about half the gain was in the constant speed prop. But the rest of it, drag reduction. And how do we know? Because we know what the airplane did with a constant speed prop when it was air-cooled. So, you know, apples to apples. Idea behind the whole project was to keep parts changed to a minimum. Originally, we had no change to any moving part within the airplane. Original piston, rings, valve seat, springs, everything. The goal was just water cool it. Let's just concentrate on that one thing. I'm not going to try and fix anything else. And we also wanted to support as many engines as possible, so modular design is very important, and I gotta give the military credit, they like doing modular design. The whole reason they have individual cylinders is so when one gets shot up, they can take it off and put another one on and go fly it. They don't have to take the whole engine apart. And we also wanted to make it really easy to convert existing aircraft. The only way a new engine or a new technology is gonna find its way into GA is that existing airframes can be changed without too much trouble. The conversion of the Cherokee takes two guys, 22 hours, and it's a bolt-on change. The engine never leaves the airframe. 22 hours, you roll it in air-cool, you roll it out water-cool. That's it. And I will confess, we drilled two new holes to mount the cowling on the top where we have it. We have some cam lock fasteners. I saw him.
So did you do this as a development project with the government under DARPA? Or are they funding it? Or do you want to help with them?
I tried getting government money every which way I could. Walt will appreciate this. But I tried the DARPA, I tried NASA's SBIR, I tried everything, and they all pretty much they looked at me, you know, and they said, you know, we're done with internal combustion engines, so good luck. So this whole project.
The Greens project.
Pardon?
The Greens project.
The Greens project?
Yeah, they just want the money for the Greens
project. Oh, okay. Well, that's, you know, keep in mind, this all started back in the late 90s. Conceptually, I came up with it in probably mid-90s, started to do engineering work in 97. We started making parts in 99, and we ran the first engine on a dyno in 2000. So it took a few years just to get to that point. This project is entirely funded by me. So, and all I will say is, this is the result of the internet. Because if it wasn't for my business in the internet business, which started in 94 and actually made some money, and then I got this crazy idea of let's make a better airplane engine, I did the old axiom. I took a big fortune and made a small one in aviation.
So, a radiator somewhere?
Pardon?
A radiator somewhere on this thing?
Yeah, there's a radiator. I'll show you coming up here. I just want to go over the parts. Cylinder assembly, and it's made out of A356 aluminum, which I feel is a better alloy than the typical stuff that Lycoming uses for their heads. More importantly, T6 hardened. By the way, A356 is used in most engine blocks, cylinder heads, performance engines. It's a nice, it's a virgin alloy as well. The coolant's contained entirely within the aluminum casting, which eliminates the possibility of coolant leakage and also eliminates galvanic erosion. Now people look at these things and go, wait, it got smaller. Okay, this is a fully assembled cylinder, okay? It's got a sleeve in it, got valves, all right? Just like an air cooler. All right, this is one that hasn't been assembled yet, no sleeve. So if you want to come up here, you know, after the presentation, take a look. What you're going to see is lots of threads in there. The sleeve threads into it, and that's how we make a final assembly. But see, there's no coolant. There's three holes. One, two, three. Those are the only coolant access to the head. There's nowhere else for the water to come or go. It's got to go through those holes. And actually, we don't even use this one. This one's just here because in the future we're planning on putting a knock sensor in there. And the best place to put a knock sensor is in the water line so that we can hear the combustion sound better. Okay? So really, water goes in here, water comes out there. Yes?
Use a thermal coupler between the cylinder head and your jacket, or are you depending on the thread and connection?
We don't use anything specific. This is an interference fit. So this is actually heated up to about 325 degrees. Same process that's used for the air-cooled heads. They're heated up, and the sleeve is threaded onto it. And the sheer contact area of both threads, which, by the way, we have almost 2 inches of them in here, okay? It's a huge amount of contact surface for heat transfer. And keep in mind that the water is literally less than a tenth of an inch away inside the jacket. So the heat transfer is so effective that we had a head scratcher happen while we were running the dyno. We always figured what the best way to build one of these engines, put oil jets in to keep the pistons cool, right? Some engines have them, some engines don't. But in the air-cooled world, cooling your pistons is a good thing. You're transferring some heat from the piston into the oil and you're getting it out of the engine. Well, we did two versions of the engine on the dyno, one with and one without the oil squirts. And without the oil squirts, we were rejecting about 280,000 BTUs an hour of heat into the water volume. Okay? That's a lot of heat, by the way. If you've got a home furnace, a really big home furnace puts out about the same amount of heat, 280,000 BTUs or thereabouts. And the oil was rejecting, if I recall, something around 85 or 90,000 BTUs an hour was coming out the oil cooler of this test engine. And then we thought, well, let's put oil jets in it and see what happens. Really strange thing happened. That 90,000 BTUs an hour coming out, the oil system dropped down to about 60. And the oil and the water rejection went up to 310. What the heck is going on here? We were cooling the oil through the piston. That's how much heat transfer is happening between the cylinder walls and the piston. So it just completely reversed the direction of the heat transfer. You know, the hot oil was squirting on the piston, transferring the heat in the piston, and we were sucking it out the cylinder walls. Okay, just remember guys, water is 1,000 times more dense than air. Air is actually better for insulating things than it is for conducting heat. So there's a huge benefit to doing this. And by the way, cooling the entire sleeve, and you'll notice, mean, we made a point of cooling all the way down to the last fin, and even where a Lycoming standard fin thing, fin cylinder is set up. So, keep thinking this advances. Yes, sorry.
T6 is a titanium alloy, or what is T6?
No, T6 is an aluminum hardness scale. Now, one of the interesting things about T6 hardness is it keeps a nice solid molecular pattern. It's well hardened. Air-cooled heads are, if you're lucky, your T3, and they're annealed. And the reason is because aluminum has a characteristic that it doesn't like to go above 325 degrees, or it starts to lose its hardness. And the more you take it over 325, the worse it gets. And then you take it up and you cool it off real slow. And you take it up and do whatever. That's what's happening to our air-cooled aluminum cylinder heads. And the best way to explain what's going on there is, as we all know, aluminum, non-ferrous metal, work hardens. Is that they're bended enough, snap. Well, the same exact thing is happening to your air-cooled heads when they're getting hot and cold. It's a thermal work hardening. And that's why usually they start cracking after 1,500 to 2,500 hours of use, depending on how heavy they've been used. Yes?
Does that mean that we can be less worried about shock cooling turbines when using
hot systems? Not only can you be less worried about it, you can completely forget about it. Shock cooling does not happen with a water-cooled engine. But an interesting thing, everyone worries about shock cooling, that's not what cracks your cylinder heads. It's shock heating, guys. Think about this for a second. You start the airplane up, it's ambient temperature, 72 degrees. You roll down to the run-up area, you run it up a little bit. You're warming it up a bit, but no big deal. Air-cooled head, you've got frigid air coming in through the intake side, you've got hot air going out the exhaust side. You've got a big lump of metal that's trying to heat up. What side gets hot first? Exhaust side. Now you finish your run-up, which isn't going to take you more than a minute or two, whatever. Crawl it down, you stand in line waiting to take the runway, and then what do? You roll on the runway, you pour the coals to that thing, and suddenly you've gone from a cylinder head temperature that was sort of meandering around a couple of hundred degrees to, 1,200, 1,300 degrees out the exhaust port and freezing cold coming in the intake port. So across the chamber, the thermal gradient can exceed 400 degrees from the intake side to the exhaust side. What do you think that does to aluminum after a while? It kills it. And most of the cracks that you'll find in aluminum heads will either be between the intake and the exhaust seats or between the exhaust seat and one of the plugs, because the thermal gradient is huge. Now, on a water-cooled head, it's non-existent because the heat's being sucked out of it so fast that at most you might end up with 50 or 60 degrees across the head. That's about it, because the whole head is bathed in the same hot water. And I might add, the water, this is really important, is a lot closer to the combustion chamber in a water-cooled head. It's about, a tenth of an inch away. You've got 1,000 times more dense fluid a tenth of an inch away. The thermal gradient across that tenth of an inch is very small. On an air-cooled head, the thermal gradient across roughly an inch of metal, because on the exhaust side, you've got up to an inch of metal between the interior of the cylinder, which is really getting hot, and you finally get to radiate that heat out. That thermal gradient is what causes a huge amount of stress. Yes?
How do you keep steam pockets out of this injection?
We'll get to that. Yes, that's a very good question. Steam pockets. How do we keep steam pockets out of it? Especially as hot as it runs. There's a sleeve. We use the same forging as the air-cooled sleeves. The company that makes the air-cooled sleeves for ECI and Lycoming, we use the same forging. Through hardened, we thickened it up a little bit because we're making more power. We plan to make more power. This area here is the combustion chamber seal. You know, when you screw these things together, there's no gaskets or anything like that in there. It is strictly pressure that seals the combustion chamber. So this is actually the chamber seal up here. We decided to taper that and make it a little larger because the original Lycoming design was straight-walled and kind of pathetic. And based on what we've known, you've got a straight wall coming in and you're pinching it down because, again, you're allowing the heating aluminum head on, you're screwing it onto the sleeve, and then you let it cool off, and the whole thing pinches down, and what happens to that straight thing? It bends in a little bit. And this is two things. One, it's taking a straight seal and kind of cocking it a little bit and putting a lot of pressure on one part of it, okay? And then that pressure, conversely, the steel is pushing back really hard on the aluminum. And this sets up a case of just adding to stress fracturing on the air-cooled heads. We felt we wanted to avoid that issue, even on the water-cooled, we just wanted to improve it. Remember, you're flying technology that's been stagnant since the 40s. Not one change, gentlemen. Not one change. And is there any other tech in the world that has stayed completely unchanged since the 40s and is still viable today? Because other than our air-cooled airplane engines, I don't know of anything. And their carburetors and accessories. Barrel finish, nickel carbide, or plain steel. A cylinder that runs at an average temperature of 200 degrees will probably, in plain steel, last 5,000 hours, and in carbide, probably last closer to 7,000 hours. So the kind of TBOs we're talking about are, you know, hard to fathom by today's standards of air-cooled engines. As I mentioned, steel liner gets screwed into the head. I won't go into that again. Now, 1940s versus 1980s. There you go. There's a 1940s combustion chamber. Your basic domed combustion chamber. There's one here if you want to get a good look at it. It's just a domed combustion chamber. This was a shrunk down Pratt & Whitney. You've got your big 18 millimeter plug there, your other one there, as far away as you can possibly put them. And in addition to putting them far away, they're pocketed. You don't want to shroud a spark plug. The whole purpose of the spark plug is to ignite the fuel air mixture going past it. So shrouding is not a good idea. We duplicated Lycoming's chamber when we made our first head because, again, our thought was same thing. We just want to liquid cool it. We don't want to have any issues with the feds. We want to make it easy to certify. Intake valve, exhaust valve. And by the way, you're looking at a part here that's been dyno run and it was taken off the engine a little while, you know, like a couple hours later. That's why it's wet and you can see stuff there. Okay, 1980s technology. Here we've got 8-to-1 compression, and here you've got 11-to-1 compression. Safely, on 100 octane avgas. Actually, it runs great on 92 pump gas, too. But we're designing for avgas, and we know it's always going to be 100 octane, or 97, or something around there. So no matter what happens to avgas, we're always going to have high octane fuel. Intake valve. That intake valve there is about 30% larger than the original. You make power by getting airflow through a cylinder. People ask me, well, it's a parallel valve. It can't make as much power as an angle valve. Well, we can theoretically make more power than an angle valve. Now, I'm not going to tell you that we've actually done it, because Murphy has really messed with our project over the years in terms of, well, mostly dyno facilities, vendors, and things that have gone wrong, and you name it. But it's really hard to do this. But the bottom line is, this cylinder has been run, and this cylinder is capable of generating 230 horsepower on a normally aspirated 0360 engine running with a carburetor at 2700 RPM.
Awesome.
Nice, huh? At 11 to 1? On 92 pump gas. So think about that. Yes? Yes. Yeah. We got a modern chamber here. This is a modern chamber. I don't have those numbers handy, but yeah, I mean, we took the spark plugs and brought them closer together by, well, over an inch, about 1.4. Yes? No.
Shaking performance.
The reason we don't bother with that is because we have to have dual plugs in order to meet spec. You know, the FAA requires a dual ignition system, so. Yes?
The shrouding, is that to minimize foul in? What's the purpose?
Well, the shrouding here, or? This was just plumbers making a combustion chamber, that's all it was. Don't give them much credit. They were cranking something out for Uncle Sam, and they were doing it in a hurry. They didn't know all the dynamics of what was going on in a combustion chamber, and that's what, you know, this gentleman here mentioned, quench. Flat areas here and here, which by the way aren't as flat as they appear, and a smaller anti-chamber. Okay, simple thing. When these spark plugs fire, you end up with two flame fronts from the opposite side of the cylinder. going towards each other at supersonic speeds. And what they're doing as that fuel and air is burning is it's compressing the remaining unburned fuel and air right in the top center of the combustion chamber. If you wanted to build an engine that detonates, you couldn't build one better than that cylinder. It's designed to detonate. So it's amazing that they don't detonate more. Because the last thing you want is to have your combustion burn from the outside in. You need your combustion to burn from the inside out so that you don't end up compressing all the unburned gases into a center mass right above the nice hot piston and the really hot exhaust valve right above it. So that's the whole reason for that design. And the other thing obviously is as the piston starts to back away, you immediately get a rapid expansion as well, which again, further helps to minimize the possibility of partial detonation. Let me tell you, we've made this cylinder detonate. It takes a little bit, but we can still make the water-cooled version of it detonate. We got to raise the induction temperature about 140 degrees to do it, okay, and mess around with the mixture and get it right around best power. And then lug the engine down to about, I think it was 1800 RPM with a wide open throttle. Now, I know nobody really flies their engine that way, but we had to do that on the dyno just to see what would happen. And yeah, when a 360 detonates, full dead. If you want to know what it feels like on a dyno or what it sounds like, and I have to imagine an airplane, it's got to be pretty wicked too, take a 10-pound sledgehammer and smack a concrete floor. That's the sound that a 360 makes when it detonates. And then do that really fast. Yeah, and then watch the entire dyno rig try and jump off the floor because it's very violent. And of course, you know, we get two or three out of it and immediately back off because we don't want something to depart the engine. Because yeah, it can. Detonation can blow a jug off the engine. So, you know, nothing's changed since 1940. Now, nobody can tell me that Lycoming couldn't have done this, even with their air-cooled cylinder, to make it better. So, yes?
With the temperature differences for liquid cool, you have found problems with letting?
Not at all, actually. Not at all. In fact, that was an interesting observation. We didn't have any lead fouling problems at all when we were running water cool, even with the 18 millimeter plugs. Now, I will say that I'm a big proponent of the extended tip 18 millimeter plugs, so the BY series, RM something, what is it? Anyone wants to know? These are the best plugs to run in an air-cooled engine because they do minimize fouling. And they are generally accepted as, I can't see the darn thing in the dark here. Huh? No, this is a standard, right? This is an aviation plug. An auto light or whatever. I can't read it without poor light, so I'm getting old. We've got away from the 18 millimeter plugs. The problem with these things is, by the way, you know, they're not called spark plugs. These are ordnance igniters. Official mil spec. They're ordnance igniters. So we went to a standard 14 mil automotive plug, platinum tip, and four electrodes.
What do you do to keep it so that it burns from the inside out?
Burns to the inside out? By having this chamber design here. Now, we're still going to have a little bit of a combined front, but it's minimal. So what we found with this is we've helped it a lot. But it's still a problem. I'm not going to tell you that it's a perfect solution here. Anytime you've got two plugs opposite each other like that, you're not getting the combustion mixture to burn properly from the inside out. What you really want is one in the middle, or even two in the middle. That would be ideal. But it's impossible with this cylinder head design to do that. Just not going to happen. But we found that the detonation resistance of this, remember, we're running at 11 to 1. We couldn't make it detonate. And here's what we did. We took the induction temperature up to 140. We did everything we tried to do. The best we could get it to do was to ping a little bit. And then I went, we'll have to fix that, take the mags and jack the timing all the way up. Now, 25 degrees is standard. We found, by the way, timing does change depending on combustion chamber design because it's all related to fuel burn rates and stuff. So our optimum peak torque timing was actually about 21 degrees thereabouts instead of 25, so a little bit less timing, all right, gives us peak torque. We jacked the timing up to 35 degrees before we actually got partial detonation. It wasn't even as bad as the other ones. 140 degrees, 35 degrees timing advance. We're so far ahead of where the timing curve needs to be. The air engine was barely putting out, you know, it was down probably about 10-11% on its power, way out of that. It was pinging away. It sounded like a bucket of bolts long before it actually started detonating. So if you couldn't hear that in the airplane, well, then you need an amplifier. Anyway, really, really important. Here's another interesting thing. Does everyone know that Lycoming heads do not have valve seals on them? In fact, most air-cooled heads do not have valve seals on them. Some Continentals do, but very few. No Lycomings do. We consider our oil consumption to be good on a Lycoming if you get a quart every 10 hours, right? Is that about right, guys? Quart every 10, that's considered decent. And you're going to change your oil every 50 or 100 hours at most, right? So, where do you think all the oil's going?
Through the valve gaskets.
That's right. Right through them, those two holes right there. And I might add, you'll be amazed at how much oil gets sucked through the exhaust valve stem. Quite a bit of negative pressure there on every exhaust stroke. So, and of course, the intake side, for obvious reasons, you've got, you know, a vacuum there, so you're tending to suck oil down the intake guide. If you want an engine to detonate, put oil in the mix. Oil is not octane. Oil is closer to cetane and diesel, not designed to prevent detonation. It's actually counteracting the effects of octane. You need to keep what's in the combustion chamber pure. Air, gas, no oil, all right? We put seals on them. Notice that we've gone to considerably smaller stems. We no longer need a $250 sodium-filled exhaust valve stem to keep the valve from melting. We just use standard high nickel, high temp, single-piece forged valves. Single-piece, not the Lycoming valves, which are spun welded. Yes?
What do you recommend for idle or low power EGT to keep running? Like in my idle 20, I generally run it about 1,000 degrees or 1,100. So what's your experience with your engine?
Well, you know, when you're idling, you're not going to foul so much as you're going to, in terms of lead fouling. And if you're talking about oil fouling, that's a different problem, okay? Long-term idle on any air-cooled engine is just going to be sucking a lot of oil into the chamber, and you're going to tend to foul a little plug just with oil fouling. If you're having problems with lead fouling, you're not flying your engine hard enough. And I know that people don't like the idea of flying their engines hard, but a carbureted engine, when you're in flight, you should leave the throttle wide open and adjust the mixture. Okay? Now granted, there are limits to what you can do with an air-cooled engine that way, but you need to keep temps up. Otherwise, you're going to precipitate out lead from the tetraethyl lead, and it's going to drain into the exhaust plug, in the lower plug. If you're going to throttle back and you're running at 60% power all the time, you're just filling the lower plug with lead, and there's no way to get around it. You just have to run it harder, and that eventually boils the lead off, you know, and it will boil the lead eventually out of the lower plug as well. But I don't have any other recommendation for that. Okay, with the water cooled situation and these kind of plugs, which by the way are the correct temperature, because that's the other reason we went to these plugs, because these are designed to run in air cooled heads. So they're not the right temperature. They actually get too cold when we're running them in a water-cooled head because they're cooled off too much. So this is the other reason why we went to a automotive spark plug. It wasn't just for convenience. We needed to get the right temperature range. Yes? Oh. Can't say enough about valve seals. Now, what you're probably noticing is we went beyond just water cooling the darn engine. Because how did this all come to develop? Okay, shoot the engineer go into production. That'd be me. Okay. But how did this happen? Well, it happened because I went to the FAA a few years back and I said, hey, I want to certify this. What do you think it's going to take? Well, you got to ask. So I had a big meeting with the ACO, the engineering department over at Long Beach here, and I forget the guy's name, this is like a long time ago. And I brought parts, and what was supposed to be a little one-on-one meeting ended up being standing room only. Like every freaking engineer in the whole place showed up in the guy's office like, wow, real airplane parts, jeez, we haven't seen any of those, we just shuffled paperwork. So, it was a good meeting, I really enjoyed it. A lot of questions, a lot of curiosity. And then the big boss said, well, Bob, he says, we wanted to find out if we could STC the modification to the Lycoming engine. And he goes, well, he says, I don't think so, he says. I have a feeling that, you know, it's too major a modification. You're going to have to recertify it as a new engine.
Yeah,
that was my reaction. I was like, oh, crap. Keep in mind, we hadn't changed a single moving part. This doesn't move. What's inside it moves, but there we go. Spark plug gas. What's inside it moves. The water pump is an accessory. Plumbing, thermostat. And the guy goes, it's too big a change. You're going to have to certify a new engine.
You're affecting his career.
Yeah. But, so what does Bob do? Bob goes, okay, well, so much for the idea of minimally invasive modification. Let's go to town and do it right. Let's go take this to the next logical step, which is, once we get the chamber temperatures down and the water cooled, we've already proven that part works, let's make more power, because that's what we want. We want more power, more efficiency, better fuel economy. So that's what precipitated a lot of this. New chamber design, new intake and exhaust ports, you know, the whole thing we've done here, lots of little, you know, valve seals, we got a better oil return here. Now we get to the piston, which is what you're seeing here, a matched piston, again, with a chamber matching relief. But I didn't stop there, because I can't help myself. All right, the bore in our 360s, 720s, 540s is five and an eighth inches. Big four, there it is. Soup cans, I like to call them, okay? Well, standard ring set is a compression ring, oil ring. We've probably all seen pistons taking things apart, hopefully. There's our piston. But here's the problem with standard compression rings when you have a big bore, slow turning engine. It's that ring gap. Okay, I know it's supposed to be smaller, but it's got a ring gap. Now, you've got maybe 170 or 185 cubic centimeters of space when the piston's at top dead center. And it comes up, it squishes all the air in there, and as all of you have done, you pull the prop through up to the compression stroke, and all you hear is this hissing sound coming from inside your engine, and you're all hoping, God, I hope that isn't a valve. Right? But actually that hissing sound is all the air going past your compression ring. It doesn't take very long, does it? By the time you pull that thing up to top dead center, it's like, boop, it just ran out of steam. There, nothing left. So amazingly enough, many moons ago, somebody came up with a gapless ring. This is not a new idea. Now it does have a gap. Well, and look, the other one has a gap. But for those of you who are familiar with multi-part rings, what this is a ring on a ring. So this little ring sits in a groove. I can't really show it too well, but it becomes one round ring, no gap. So the gaps are there so the ring can open and close, but they're opposite each other because one ring's laying over the other. Now, talk about efficiency. On a slow turning engine, that's, you know, 2700 RPM, it's like idle. It's like a diesel. We actually fly diesel engines that happen to have a spark plug, all right, in terms of the way they're built and everything else. So we decided, change the number two ring to a gapless ring, get a little bit more power out of it. And oh, by the way, on the Cherokee, I have to warn people who get curious and go grab my prop and try and pull it through. First thing they run into is, God, that thing is stiff. Well, yeah, because it's not leaking down as you're pulling it up on a compression stroke. And then it's like, stand back. I don't want you to hurt yourself. And I'll pull it up to the top of the compression stroke and I'll say, stand the hell away from that prop. And then I'll casually tap the blade. And if you had your arm in the way, it'd break it. Because it hasn't leaked down. It's leaking down a tiny amount. I mean, I couldn't let it sit there for 30 seconds. It'd be completely leaked down. But the point is, just this makes a huge difference in efficiencies. And more importantly, and this is the part I love, oil. You guys all know the condition of your oil after you've run it for 10 hours or 20 hours. It's as black as soot. You know why it's black as soot?
Carbon. Blow by.
Exactly. partially burned hydrocarbons and all the other wonderful additives in the fuel all being diluted into your oil and forming some really nasty acids, I might add. All right, the lead part of that is what does the most harm, by the way. And so you stop that blow by, and amazingly enough, after 50 hours, your oil looks as clean as when you put it in. That's just phenomenal on an airplane engine, but we take it for granted on a car engine. Because all car engines, now mind you, most car engines don't have gap and spring, so they're gonna have more blow by. So this is all part and parcel of what we try to take forward now. We've gone beyond liquid cooling and trying to take it forward into improving the engine overall. Water pump, in answer to your question, sorry.
I was just saying, even though you got two rings there, don't they eventually line up?
Ah, you can say that. Can't really see it too well, but look carefully. See this little tab here? And there's a little slot there. When you come up, take a look.
Oh, there's a prevention.
It's a prevention, yeah. So the rings can't count, can't rotate. And oh, by the way, that's our design. We went back to the ring manufacturer who's been building these things for years and putting them in diesel engines and really big, you know, other engines.
So you got
and we said, hey, your rings keep rotating around and the gaps line up after a while. Well, that's never happened before.
Yeah.
Well, there may be some truth to that. See, they put the rings in most engines in straight jugs, in straight cylinders. But airplane engine cylinders are not straight. They're actually tapered. You got a little bit of swish. So the bore is not perfectly cylindrical. So what's happening to the rings in our engine is they're constantly being rattled back, you know, in and out, and then that allows them to travel. But in a regular engine, once they're set, the ring is not, you know, as the piston goes up and down, is not being, you know, expanded and contracted so much. So they're probably correct. So that's one of the reasons why we had to put that in. And oh, by the way, the whole thing on taper, you know, cylinder taper and all that kind of stuff, it's really a function of when you put the thing together. We take a straight bore, we screw it into this. It cools down, it squeezes it. Taper, right there. Now, of course, when it heats up, it tends to kinda straighten out a little bit, but it doesn't fully straighten out, obviously, because it's not gonna get up to the same temperature as when we assemble it. So, but yes, good eye. I like the fact that people are noticing things like that. Answer your question earlier, sir, about steam pockets. That pump there, original pump was designed as a replacement pump on a Cosworth Race engine by my chief engineer, my chief tool making guy, I should say. And it was designed to put out way more water, both in terms of pressure and volume, at a lower power consumption. So it's a very highly efficient impeller design. Okay? And in the race world, every extra horsepower you can get to the wheels matters. Okay? So this particular pump in its configuration provides, in a typical installation, about 27 pounds per square inch of pressure at about 33 to 35 gallons a minute. Now, that doesn't maybe sound like a lot, but I would say, turn your jacuzzi on. You know that big pump that's moving a lot of water? You know, especially when it's moving 35 and then neck it down to a hole about this big, you know, and put some pressure behind it. Yeah, you'll find out what that is. It's a lot of water moving around. Some engine developers and some engine people like to say, you need 90 gallons a minute. No, speed is not the problem. Pressure is the problem. So not only are we building pressure with the pump inside the head, but we've also got static pressure on a system of 20 pounds. So the fundamental water pressure inside the head is knocking 50 psi, sure. And it's moving at 35 gallons a minute. No steam pockets. But I'll go one step further. While you can't see it in this water jacket, it's gated internally. So we are directing water down and up into the port area, all right, so that we maintain about 60% water flow around the exhaust port. And the other 40% gets directed down and taken circularly around on its way up and out. So, been very carefully designed to minimize the possibility of steam pockets. And in fact, we don't have any. But I can't stress enough, pressure and flow, absolutely essential. Those of you who have ever seen the Continental liquid-cooled engine, does anyone know it exists? You know, the one that flew around the world with Rutan on the back of a Voyager, right? But has anyone else seen their so-called 550 liquid-cooled? The one that likes to throw rods that nobody uses because it throws rods and the water pump leaks after a couple hundred hours. The problem with that engine is, if you look at the water pump, it's about the size of a vacuum pump. The plumbing on that engine is, I don't know, for lack of a better word, I think my finger is about the right diameter. It's too small. And I've seen the installation, the extra 400 or whatever, and there's another aircraft I looked at. And you know, the radiator for an engine that's supposedly putting out over 400 horsepower was 12 inches square. It was this little cube. Now the oil cooler sitting behind it was this big. So clearly they're getting rid of a lot more heat through the oil than they are through the water. And when I looked at the size of the fittings to the radiator, I knew they weren't moving enough water around, because we've gone through this already. This is a dash 20 fitting. A dash 16 won't work. We already tried that. So make no doubt about it, if you don't have the right size fittings, I can tell how much water is moving around that engine. You know, Continental doesn't have anywhere near enough water going around their engine. It's basically a big steam pocket. And in fact, one of the interesting calls I got when I first started this, and I put the company online, the website and everything, in the early 2000s, I got a call from somebody in the Midwest, and they said, hey, you guys fix those water-cooled heads? No, we make our own. Oh, he says, well, I said, well, what's the problem? He says, oh, we got all these Continental water-cooled heads with cracks in them. And I'm thinking to myself, that shouldn't happen. Shouldn't be cracking. But as it turns out, after I took a little closer look at things, I figured out why. Because you've got nothing but steam pockets going on in there. You've got basically a steam pocket expands and disappears. It's like throwing cold water on a red hot aluminum frying pan every few seconds, and it's going to kill it after a while. So, back to the thermostat. Here's the right thermostat. This is called a balanced sleeve design. Been around for years, nothing new. If anyone's done any performance work, they'll know. I'm going to pull the back side of this off. This is your typical, you know, flat plate design that you'll see in virtually every car. Well, the problem with this design is water pressure builds up on the back, which is where all the heat is, and the thermostat has to open by moving backwards into that pressure. And it's basically a flat plate, which is, you know, trying to let the water flow around it. The flow difference between this thermostat and, well, it's basically the same thing, but, and this thermostat, it's like 300% different. And this thermostat's not sensitive to water pressure at all, because it's designed to have like a bowl. It's a bowl on the back that just slides away and lets the water around it and through it. And then there's lessons we learn about thermostat design. I always thought this was a great idea. Because, you know, water's always moving around an engine. Pump's pumping, whether it's going to the radiator or not is the material, it's always going around the engine. So water gets up to the thermostat housing and it comes in through the hot lines, and it's either going to go back to the engine or it's going to go out the radiator. That's small for a reason, because you want to bias it going to the radiator when it's time to go to the radiator. You know, this will flow enough to do the job, but when you need to go to the radiator, you need a little bit more encouragement. However, in the area of encouragement, we thought, oh, what a great idea this would be. When the thermostat opens enough, we actually want to plug the return line and force all the water to the radiator. Does that seem like a good idea? I might add, it's what the Japanese did on a lot of their early engines and whatnot, and they seem to have a lot of good cooling efficiency, and they had small radiators, and we thought, well, that should work for us in the airplane business, and it turned out to be a terrible idea. Because with a pump that can pump what that pump pumps, when this thing starts to open, this plate gets closer and closer to the back side of this, and as it gets close to that, eventually it gets sucked into it. Which pulls the thermostat open instantly. Now that's not such a bad thing until you realize that even though this is a big hole, the radiator can't take the entire flow of the pump. It can only flow about 28 gallons a minute, and water is not compressible.
All right.
So, the last thing you want is really hot water being sucked on real hard by a pump, because what happens then? Cavitates, thank you, right there, I had a little... it cavitates, and that is actually a very violent thing. Cavitates for a moment, loses pressure, thermostat moves away, grabs the water, it goes. It creates very high torque values on the input drive of the pump. In the area of lessons learned, we witnessed this happening on the dyno more than once. We saw the plumbing start to jump around, and we did this when we were goofing with the temperature. We were trying to like, oh, let's raise the temperature of the engine up to near red line or get it up around, you know, yellow arc, and, you know, by turning the cooling tower down. And all of a sudden we're watching the, you know, of course we had a really long run of plumbing, and it's just sort of just dancing around like this. I'm like, well, there's pressure pulsations there, but it doesn't jive with anything that we're seeing on the data. We actually put analog pressure meters in there, and we couldn't see, because it's doing this. Even though we're seeing that, what we were seeing is a low frequency resonance of the plumbing. We weren't realizing that it's bouncing up and down many times a second, right? So suffice it to say, one day during test flying, I found out what happens when you let that continue too long. Because it's interesting flying an airplane that starts to have that same thing. And you're sitting in the airplane, everything's going well, and then all of a sudden you get this little, your airplane's just sort of doing this little shaking. But it's slow, it's not violent. And I'm thinking, wow, if this is a little bit of flutter, this doesn't make any sense. And I'm looking, I slow down, it just a little less. Put it faster, a little bit more. I have the thing fully instrumented, by the way, speaking of full instrumentation, there's this little visual box here that was hooked to my computer at the time, taking data directly from the box on the cooling system. And take that, combined with some misfiring that we had because our muffler was a little too restrictive, so we had way too much back pressure. Suffice to say, at about 4,500 feet, it gave up the ghost. Water pressure went to zero, and I went, oops, gotta land. That wasn't really a big deal, as big as it might sound, because I had this piece of equipment here, and I'll show you a bigger picture of it. But this device here is not just a temperature gauge. It's a cooling system analyzer. The instant that pump stopped pumping, I had a warning light. The instant it stopped. So all I had to do was throttle back and go, watch the temperature, keep on going. Made a safe landing, no big deal. And I got the data to show for it, which is kind of interesting. But part and parcel of, there's more to creating a liquid-cooled engine than just the hardware. Plumbing that goes in between cylinders, you may not realize it, but your engine does move around a bit. You know, the torque that comes off that propeller into the crankshaft and the block and everything else, the distance from one cylinder to the next changes slightly, especially when you're yawing back and forth and doing things on the rudder. You probably, you know, don't realize how much is going on there. So this plumbing is designed to both be modular and to allow a certain degree of flex from one cylinder to the next. Very small, but does the job. And finally, there's the gauge. All right. Unlike oil, when you have a leak with oil, you see it. Makes a mess. Water evaporates. At best, you might get a little streak of green where the antifreeze is drying out. Do you want to have to decal your airplane every time for pre-flight to see if you got a little bit of dribble of antifreeze somewhere?
No,
not practical. That yellow light down there came to me while I was driving between Quebec and Montreal in a GM product. Boogieing down the road, and all of a sudden the little yellow light comes on. It says coolant. And like a smart-ass engineer, I went, puh! It's a little low on coolant in the reserve bottle. I'll have to stop eventually and fix it. Temperature was okay, boogieing along. But then after a while, I got a bing, and the temperature is dead. I'm like, wow, well, it is worse than I thought. So pulled off, went to a place where they only spoke French. Thank God my wife was with me, because she speaks French too. And I found out that it blew the block heater out of it while we were running down the road. Canadian cars, they put block heaters in them so that they don't freeze and you can, you know, start them in the winter. But as it turns out, that little yellow light, GM had the forethought. They realized that coolant pressure, coolant had escaped from the system. So I got an immediate warning when that leak started, and I chose to ignore it because I thought better. I thought, oh, it's just the overflow bottle's a little low. So that's where this came from. That yellow light there, gentlemen, is a lot more sophisticated on this. You see, you want to be able to start your engine up, go to the run-up area, and before you take off, you know you have a properly functioning cooling system. So that yellow light down there can detect as little as 8 fluid ounces missing from your cooling system in a 2-gallon system. And that's not a really big problem, because as it turns out, what really becomes a problem is pressure. So that's why there's a pressure side. Just like on your oil pressure, this side of the gauge shows pump pressure. As long as you've got pump pressure above the yellow, no big deal. Keep on flying. Keep power where it is, not an issue. Temperature will remain where it's supposed to be. The last indicator of a failed cooling system is temperature. So keep that in mind. This gauge warns you when less than 8 ounces of fluid leaves the system. Then the pressure side gives you a clue as to how well is it still circulating water while you're leaking. If it's not just a solid light, it's got 2 stages. Solid, slow blink, fast blink. Slow blink is we are seeing, we've got a sensor, port sensor, in the radiator that can detect the density of the water going past it. And when it sees that density drop because there's too much air in it, that sensor goes off and gives you a slow blink on the low coolant. That says, you know, if you're not looking for a place to land, you should start getting on the job. But in the meantime, as long as temperature's staying where it should, as long as you've got pump pressure, you don't have a crisis. Okay. Continue to lose fluid at a greater than normal rate, and now you start to lose pump pressure. At the same time, you start to develop steam in the system. This actually creates an overpressure. Ooh, that's where things get bad. You want to stop an overpressure. The only way to stop an overpressure is stop generating so much heat. So when that light blinks really fast, you're generating an overpressure. You're actually forcing water out of the system now through the pressure cap. Throttle back. Not a big deal, we'll still keep flying. You don't need 100%, you can probably bring it down to 50 or 60%, you'll be fine, okay? Finally, when you get down to the yellow, you're really out of fluid, you're gonna start seeing your temperature climb, okay? Still not gonna be the end of the world. As long as there's some coolant in there, you're not gonna seize it, right? How long can you fly like that? Well, it depends how bad the leak is, but since we don't use hose clamps, we use all AN fittings, in case anyone hadn't noticed, all, you know, 500 PSI rated plumbing, fittings, and everything else. You know what actually happens with AN fittings, particularly the large ones that are kind of annoying for that? You gotta retorque them when they're hot. They tend to drip. That's their worst offense. The system is designed to not suffer catastrophic failure. Theoretically, it's impossible. There's not a single way that a fitting can slip off such that you could end up, you know, like, these kind of things here, these are all bolted in place. You can't just like, you know, well, things on those. You can't just pop one off and lose all your coolant all at once, okay? So, all I can tell you is, when people worry about leaks, leaks are not the big problem, all right? Coolant pump failure, gear driven, not the big problem. But if you have proper instrumentation, you can see instantly when there's something wrong with the system, and that's what you really need. I don't care whether you fly this engine or fly an automotive engine, that's the instrument you need if you're gonna fly a water-cooled engine. Because if you don't have that, you're flying basically on faith, you know, and you're not gonna know if you've had a problem with your system until the temperature runs away. And at that point, when the temperature runs away, you have a crisis, you need to solve it fast.
Is there an overflow system in this?
Yes, it's actually a full closed system with an overflow expansion tank. We typically make that out of aluminum with a sight tube, and it's designed to be operated fully inverted if you want.
So you get negative pressure on coolant as well?
Negative pressure.
What happens is it generates pressure when it's hot, and then...
goes in the overflow tank, which also has a pressure cap on it.
Right, but so when it cools, it sucks some back, right?
That's right. Well, it's not going to cool while you're flying. Actually, interestingly enough, the little thing we've noticed, because aluminum has such an expansion contraction coefficient, we found that even when the system is completely cold, there's about 2 to 3 psi water pressure statically in the system. Because the aluminum just shrinks around the water a little bit and it just stays that way. So it's kind of interesting. Yes?
When you first fill a system with water, do you have to do any kind of bleeding process to get air bubbles out?
Yeah, but it's not that terribly difficult. We went out of our way with the thermostat housing design that this is usually placed near the top of the engine. So everything pretty well percolates through it. In addition, this is a pump impeller cover, and it's got a little hole that bleeds air out of the pump as well, so you don't end up with a small air pocket in there. Generally speaking, I find you fill it up, you start it on the ground. I usually run it. I have a funnel, Prestone funnel, that I usually just sits right in here, nice and secure. And I'll fire it up on the ground. It'll suck whatever water down in there, and then I'll just top it off until it doesn't need any more. Pull the funnel out, put the cap on, and at that point, it's good enough to fly. You know, you really don't have to go through any huge gyrations to get the air out of the system.
So I have a question about the inverter capability.
You can keep this inverted all day long, it doesn't matter. It doesn't know which way's up. It's totally sealed. So unlike the oil system, which has got oil flopping around inside the engine, where you have to deal with that problem, you know, you've got to have your pickups and everything's got to work the way it's supposed to with the shuttle thing that so that the oil makes its way back to the pump. That's not the case with this. It's a totally sealed system. And in fact, you know, ultimately no air. You know, air eventually percolates out of it under normal circumstances. You don't have to worry about it.
Does that mean that the oil system is also modified such that it's also...
We haven't touched the oil system. We're just dealing with water. So the base engine we haven't changed. I'm just saying that the cooling system can be kept inverted indefinitely. It's not going to bother it.
So the oil system is not designed to be inverted and then you still need to switch.
The oil system is part of the base engine, and we haven't touched the oil system. Much as we'd like to mess with the oil pump because there's some issues there. But again, 1940s oil pumps, you know, they've learned a few things over the years what to do with oil pumps. Yes?
Old knock-on trick is the real weak hole in the thermostat. That'll probably help your pressure differential situation too.
There is a built-in weak hole on these. That's just for letting air out. But it's not a pressure differential. This flows water, a balancedly designed, and this does not. This is a piece of crap to put in a car. This is what you put in a high performance engine that needs to move water around it. So
who's talking about water pockets?
Well, air pockets are
air pockets, but behind the thermostat and an
old
hot rod.
Oh, I touched the car.
It's kind of people. You shouldn't get it from water pockets.
Well, air is going to be, you know, caught little pockets here and there. When you first fill the system up, there's going to be little bubbles of air here and there, but it's minimal, and it's easily bled out of the system.
Is there a way, they use a line
highest
point with a orifice restriction?
Right. This is the highest point. Because the radiator is frequently lower in an aircraft installation.
Well,
we're not going to
have
that.
Jugs, it may have a hard time on its way out.
No, these things, the way they're set up, they sit like this. There's nowhere for air to hide in here. It's all going to come out here. There's just absolutely no place for air to hide in here. And we did that on purpose when we designed it. We didn't want to end up with any air pockets finding them, you know, getting stuck inside the jug.
Bummer. Is the radiator metal?
It's aluminum. Yeah, aluminum is preferred. Come to life.
It'll come around.
I know, it's taking
a month. Where's the radiator? Under the plane?
In our Cherokee 180, we managed to find a place for it behind the engine on the co-pilot side, and it's attached to the engine mount there, and then it's fed with an air duct from the lower scoop up to it, and it's a combined unit of water and oil in one unit. They're two separate radiators, but they just happen to be welded together into a single unit so we can have a single air source feed them.
So that small neck of input really cools it well.
Well, yeah, that small, in fact, that's actually oversized because, well, the whole radiator thing is a story unto itself. You know, when I went into this, my friend Tom, who's my chief tooling guy, I walked into his shop and said, I got this great idea, you know. What do you think, you know, to get it done, you know, what do you think it's going to take? And I said, I thought I figured it out. By the way, that's what a dyno engine looks like when it's running full whack. I said, oh, you know, I was thinking maybe at worst case, 80 grand to get this whole thing done. $750,000, guys, and you're looking at the parts. It's not done yet. So I think 80 grand was a little bit of an underestimation on my part. Yeah, that's what your exhaust looks like in your airplane, by the way, when you're flying. But interesting enough, you know, at this point here, it's 260 degrees, and at the pipe, it's 1,500. Yes? Pardon? What are the next steps? Well, the next step is the third generation head because, well, we had a couple of issues with the one that before that where we made a mistake on the intake port. But I'll get to that a bit, hopefully before too long. That engine run is a pretty typical thing, 1520 EGT, running at, you know, 70 degrees leading to peak, nice long burn, trying to really cook things. This is what it looks like. There's your exhaust valve, nice and cool, no big deal. Oil, water everywhere. Swirl pattern on the piston. That's looking into the exhaust port. Does anyone know what the white stuff is? Lead? Tetraethyl lead that's been precipitated out of the exhaust stream. The valve is so cold, temperature-wise, that it precipitates lead readily out of the exhaust stream. By the way, that's why plugs tend to build lead up because they're cold and they suck the, you know, they precipitate it out. And by the way, this here, this close up here, that's the oil sort of dribbling down the guide. But that's after running 2 hours, 1500 degrees Fahrenheit. That cylinder was pulled off, was still hot to handle. You know, we tried to get it off and take pictures of it as fast as we could. Before and after, air cooled, water cooled. Very minimal change. You're asking about radiators. About 60% of our budget, of that $750,000, has been spent trying to make this thing fly. That's how hard it is to get them to fly. Reliable. To be certified reliable. In other words, to present this to the FAA as a certifiable installation. Okay, that was our goal. Radiators, 9 versions of radiators. Wow. Lots of geniuses telling me how to build a radiator. That was one of them. 6 inches deep, double pass front to back. Didn't even come close to working. It's no fun taking off and watching everything overheat on downwind and come landing. Yes?
What's the weight difference?
Well, if you hang it on the end of the crane, it's about, with water, radiator brackets, and everything else, it's about 50 pounds. Keep in mind, there's almost 3 gallons of water and 8 pounds a gallon, that's most of the weight. The actual cylinders actually weigh half a pound less than their air-cooled counterparts, but without water, obviously. Pump weighs, well, not as big and heavy as that, but it weighs quite a bit less. But you can't use that as the guide. The Cherokee installation actually, the total net gain on the airplane was less than 8 pounds. The simple reason for that was that we took a 40-pound cowling off and replaced it with a 12-pound cowling. By the way, where's all the weight? It's not there, which is where everyone worries about. The prop. Where do you think all the CG of the weight gain is? Damn right, it's back here. You know the effective change of the CG on the Cherokee was? An eighth of an inch forward. And then, as I was doing all the paperwork for the FAA, I discovered that Piper never included the ELT in standard equipment list. So my empty weight CG actually went back. well, we all know where it was all along, but according to the paperwork, it went backwards. New radiator, there you go. 12 inches by 12 inches, there's your oil cooler down there, and 3 inches deep. Now, without getting into too much, I'm gonna give you guys $100,000 piece of information, because they like you. I kid you not. This one piece of information cost $100,000 and several years. The secret to an efficient aircraft radiator is 8 to 10 fins per inch. The typical automotive radiator, 18 to 22 fins per inch. Fins per inch is, I don't think I have a better picture of that radiator. Okay? How many times the fins go back and forth in the period of an inch? All right? My camera's running out of tape, so I'm going to have to change it in a minute. And that allows enough flow to go through, minimal cooling drag, which for us is about 3 inches of water. 3 inches of water is our radiator cooling drag versus 10 inches of water for the air cooling installation. That is a massive drag reduction. Yes, there's more volume of air going through. No, it's not a penalty. It's a good thing. So the other thing is obviously, tubes. There's more to the radiator than meets the eye. It is completely custom designed for the Cherokee installation. And for most aircraft, you'd have to custom design something to fit the airframe in the best way possible. You know, there's lots of different ways to skin the cat. Yes?
In cooling, did you try AC evaporative coolers and all of that experiments?
No, because again, AC evaporative coolers typically have an inner core in there, which is actually designed to slow the fluid movement through it. And that's the last thing we actually need to keep the water side pressure lower. As I mentioned earlier, we're moving 35 gallons a minute. This radiator will only move about 24, 25, maybe even less, but that's somewhere around 24 gallons a minute. The last thing you want to do is slow the fluid going down. What you really want is maximum thermal transfer in an aircraft in the smallest possible package, because it's weight and size. And in fact, the interesting thing about doing radiator development, guys, the last time anybody did any serious radiator development for a piston aircraft was pre-World War II. And the radiators that they built were for flying tanks like the P-38 and the P-51. Size and weight was not an issue. And they were built like reverse boilers. Big old drum with a bunch of tubes through it.
Well, it also has deep, more dynamic pressure because of the speed those aircraft operated at. These have to work at slower speeds.
Yes and no. They were building radiators back then with the knowledge that they had. And in fact, P-51 radiators are notoriously, like, if you don't keep speed up on an aircraft, you overheat real fast. But they're also horribly inefficient in their thermal transfer. You'd say, yeah, okay, this is not designed to fly at 400 or 500 miles an hour. But you're never going to feed a radiator with full airspeed. Notice the intake. Usually the main calculation is you want to do anywhere from a 4 to 6 to 1 expansion from your intake to your radiator face. And that's exactly what the P-51 should have done too. Now, hey, you're talking about an aircraft that makes a couple thousand horsepower, flies several hundred miles an hour faster than a typical GA aircraft, and under the right conditions, theoretically generates thrust from its cooling system, which, that's impressive. But that's because it has a monumental amount of heat to get rid of. So that's where the thrust part. We're talking a 200 horse engine. Not ever, ever gonna generate enough heat to make thrust. So at this point, it's different. It's a different animal. GA aircraft, nobody spent any time thinking about radiators for a passenger private aircraft. Fighter aircraft, different issues. And I might add, way back then, they were just trying to get something to work. But believe me, if they had to redesign the radiator for the P-51, it'd be a totally different design by today's standards. Probably be half the size, half the weight, and twice as thermally efficient as the one that they got in there, and you wouldn't have any low speed cooling problems. Interestingly enough, speaking of low speed, we all know we have to tax it. Hey, Walt?
What is the effect on engine noise with your modification?
A fair reduction in perceived noise, but interestingly enough, It's, I say perceived because by jacketing the combustion chamber with water, a lot of the high frequency combustion noises get muffled. Now, I've got a sound pressure meter and I pay attention to the noise levels in the aircraft. And really what I noticed was approximately a 2 dB reduction in noise level in the aircraft. But amazingly enough, I can hear the magnetos. Can you hear your magnetos running? I can hear them doing their thing. Because all the high frequency noises have gone away from the engine, and that's about the only thing left. And of course, the magnetos are just on the other side of the firewall there from the cockpit. I was really quite surprised. I was flying along one day, and I did have a flight engineer with me, and he says, "What's that noise? Kind of sounds like a magneto." Well, the flight engineer was also an AMP, so he knew what they were. I said, "You know, I think that's what it is." And sure enough, yeah, turned out the bags. It's you get that benefit, but there's one more thing to go on that, and that is air-cooled versus liquid-cooled. Where do you guys think most of the noise enters the cabin from?
Exhaust.
The frame.
A little bit of frame, not so much the prop. You like to put lots of insulation on the firewall because you think it's coming through there, right? Along the sides, the cabin, and everything else. But what about your windshield?
Yeah.
What about your cowling? Have you opened the hood of a modern car? You notice how much soundproofing there is in the hood? Because that's where the majority of the noise is coming from. As it turns out, if you could encapsulate the cowling of an aircraft, you'd have a Lexus to fly. Serious. And that's one of the things we hope to do. We haven't gotten done it yet, but that was another thing. Because we're water-cooled now, I don't have a pressure cowling. So we do plan to fully sound encapsulate the engine. Has two benefits. One, contains the thermal energy, which, by the way, I don't have a lot of air volume moving through there, so that red hot exhaust you saw in the dyno picture, you can imagine how hot it is in this one, okay? And we expect actually to achieve, I'm hoping to achieve, at least another 6 decibels or better of sound reduction. 6 decibels is huge. In my airplane today, I can have a conversation with the guy in the seat next to me, and we don't need headsets. And I don't exactly have to yell, but you can tell I'm kind of a loud speaker anyway, right? But it's really not difficult. That's because all the high frequency noise is gone. It's still thumping pretty good. A lot of the engine noise, you know, from the exhaust and whatnot is coming through, and that's because we haven't sound insulated the cowling. But these are the kinds of things that come out of water cooling. The side benefits are huge. Cabin heat. How many of you like to use your cabin heater knowing that it's wrapped around your exhaust? And there's just O2 thin stainless steel between you and death. Okay, water-cooled engine, not an issue. Because you use a water-to-air heat exchanger for your cabin heat. Works great, yes?
So you're doing your testing on a Cherokee 180, but what is your target market? Is it the Cirrus and the 7-Up? Or Wallace market, or what do you think you can make money
with? Well, that's interesting you say that. Target market basically is anything with a Lycoming engine, and oddly enough, Cirrus has a Continental. I've already talked to them. They have, you know, here's the sad reality about the way the GA market works. And I'll tell you the story with Piper. Since we did a Piper, went to Piper. I went to Chuck Suma, president and CEO of Piper, at the 2004 AOPA convention. Which, by the way, we flew the Cherokee to that, and it was on static display on the ramp. And Piper was just up the way from us. We thought we might attract a little attention from them. Like, wow, what the hell's that? Nobody came by. Not one person from Piper Aircraft came by to go, that's interesting. So then I went to Chuck Suma personally, took my little folder of pictures and everything, and I said, hey, Chuck, come take a look. You might be interested in this. I said, I'm willing to make an offer. Here's the offer. You provide the airframe. We will convert that to water cooling at our expense. We will support firewall forward on that airframe for 2 years while you guys do whatever you want with it. But as long as you get it to the air shows, we want to see some marketing done, some market research. But you test fly it, fly the wings off, and it's your airplane. If at the end of 2 years, Chuck, you don't think this has any potential, we'll put the airplane back the way it was at our own expense, and we'll park them. Now, does that sound like a pretty reasonable offer? I didn't even get an answer back.
He's probably too used to a worry not paying or something.
Probably. But the sad fact of it is, this is OEMs and GA. I met at Oshkosh 2001 when we were out there. By the way, we flew an airplane out to Oshkosh. I'm not going to mention the pilot of the Long Easy that flew it out there, but if anyone knows who it is, that's fine. But we have no business relationship anymore, so that's why I'm not going to mention the individual's name. I met with the VP of Engineering of Mooney Aircraft, and the very words from his mouth were, there's nothing your engine can do to make our airplane any better. This is the VP of Engineering of Mooney, the company that decided to take a Porsche PFM engine on. Okay? Little did I know that when I was talking to the guy, 3 days earlier, they filed for bankruptcy. Is there any wonder why they filed for bankruptcy? All right? I could go on with this list of things. Here's the problem, guys. Nobody wants change. The OEMs don't want change. They don't need change. They have an impenetrable market that's highly regulated by the FAA. As long as it doesn't get upset, as long as somebody doesn't come in with a better idea, it's not going to change. So to answer your question more fully, what we found the realization of is, first we thought, well, we're going to have to get an OEM on board. Now the OEMs come back and go, well, get it certified first. Well, there's a chicken and the egg problem. Yeah, $4 million to try and get the engine certified, which, by the way, just certifies the engine, doesn't necessarily certify the installation, but of course, we only hit two birds with one stone and do the charity. Okay? But, you know, realistically, firewall forward, that's $60,000 on that airplane. That's $60,000 today. By the time you get it done, it might be 80. But you'd say, wow, that's a lot of money to put into a 1971 PA-28-180. And I'll go try and buy a new one for less than $300,000. It's actually a pretty good deal, because that airplane will outfly an Aero 4. And it's got fixed gear, which means cheap insurance. So,
I was thinking about the horsepower you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
The rocket ship.
Yeah.
And the fuel economy is better on this one.
Right. So the thing is, yeah, frankly, I don't know what that airplane's going to be like with 230 pounds in front of it with the weight. And everyone keeps asking about the weight. It's reasonable. But you realize a 230 horsepower engine is usually a 540.
Right.
So do I weigh more than a 540 or less? I'm pretty sure it's less. So that's the thing. This is where water cooling, liquid cooling takes you forward. Less weight, more power, more efficiency, soundproofing, better heat, more reliability, longer TBO. I mean, our TBO, our desired TBO is 5,000 hours, okay? 360s, the bottom end of 360s do 5,000 hours, very easy to know, real problem. The real problem with most engines is they sit around too long, number one, and because of all the blow-by, all the crap in the gas, they heat things up. Well, our feeling is, just going to a gapless range should minimize blow-by, which means a lot less crap gets into the oil. And, you know, you need to fly. I mean, it's still getting around that. But 5,000-hour TBO is definitely doable. Will we actually be able to achieve that? Guess what? The FAA is in the business of regulating TBOs, even though there's not a single regulation that addresses that. See, the problem we ran into with the FAA is, and the reason we did this is we looked at the regs and it said, look, to certify an engine, it's printed in the regs. Do this, 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 and this, and you're done. 150 hours, by the way, not much. It turns out it's pretty valuable, 150 hours, right? You run at certain power levels for certain durations, blah, blah, blah. You tear the engine down, you make sure there's no weird wear. You know, you pass all the things, you should be done. It's printed right there in the regulations. Nope. The engine director in New England says, well, that's just a guy. We want new engines to be run for 200 hours at maximum continuous power. What? The original Lycoming wasn't certified for 200 hours MCP, which is basically wide open throttle at sea level for 200 hours. What if the bottom end breaks? It's not my engine. You know? Okay, I realize we might be putting more power out of it, but we're not going to go nuts and try and certify a 230 horsepower version of it. We might certify a 200 horse with momentary bursts of 230. there's reasons for that. But then that gets into, you know, you got a three main bearing crank, and I can go on with, you know, there's certain things you have to deal with in reality. But the bottom line is, this is what we're faced with in our marketplace. It's terribly overregulated. The existing companies, like Lycoming and Continental and Piper and Cessna, they don't have to change. Nobody's asking for anything, you know? And unfortunately, this is killing GA. Let me move on a little bit, because we have to do something about the muffler. See that red hot thing that you saw in the dyno picture? We didn't exactly have something there glowing red hot underneath our oil pan and right behind our alternator and everything else. So that muffler is basically a 4-to-1 box with some minor baffling. I know we screwed around with baffling and it turned out to be a waste of time. But it's heavily insulated. It's a muffler with a stainless casing around it with half an inch of aluminum silica furnace insulation.
Fiberfax.
Basically, Fiberfax is the trade name, yeah. And so the outside temperature of that muffler is roughly 200 degrees when the exhaust is about 1400. And yeah, we took it down actually 4 dBA. That was when all was said and done. I think that's what we got. Because it wasn't just this, but it was the muffler combined and the lower frequencies.
Did you have airflow in that stainless box?
We don't have it in the box. What's hard to show is the cowling right underneath the muffler, right above the inlet port, sort of in here. We have some scrub air coming up under there. And what that does is it the air gets forced in and effectively around and up the sides of the cowling and then out. Because you want some scrub air. It's scrub air. It's a draft.
And you can't box up the pipes, so correct, right?
You could, but we don't do it. What we do instead is we fiberfax the cowling, put a reflective aluminum, reflective heat shielding, and the scrub air, which remember I said earlier, air actually makes a better insulator than it does a conductor. Just having that little bit of scrub air coming out sideways and up the sides of the cowling insulates the heat transfer from the pipes to the cowling plus the fiberfax. And, you know, personally, the worst part was number one. It was the right side. You know, after landing or whatever, I just, you know, grab a hold of the lower cheek of the cowling and I burned my hand. It was pretty damn hot, all right? And that's after landing, so the thing's been idling for a while, you know? So once we fixed it all up and got the muffler properly insulated and put the fiberfax and the reflective heat shielding on the cowling, it's not even an issue. Not even an issue. You can see what the intake looks like. It kind of looks like we have a divider in there, but that's really not a divider. It's just a reinforcing bit in the middle. You got your induction side here, you got your radiator side there. That little hole provides a little scrub air for the downpipe from the exhaust so that it's not glowing cherry red inside the cowling heater. 60 square inches is the total opening. As it turns out, it's probably about 30% larger than it needs to be. This kept getting bigger because we were fighting with the radiator and we didn't understand what wasn't working. Did we not have enough air or too little or whatever? And so we made this bigger than it needs to be. The next version would be about 40 square inches or so. And really just the drag reduction, I can't say enough about what that does, you know, in terms of, and oh, we do get about a half to 3/4 of an inch of mercury of induction ram air out of this, which is a nice little boost. I don't know how much horsepower that's actually adding, but, you know.
It's free.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Would your sales pitches be that you can use with your car gas?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we run that engine on 87 pump gas. Works great.
No. 87?
87. Oh, on the low compression one. We're only running, that one runs 9.2 to 1, which is the older chambers. We haven't started flying the newer chambers yet. The newer chambers I wouldn't run on less than 92, just for, you know, no real reason to. Yes?
One of the things I was told that while running pump gas is that I used to see an ethanol line of it, but you guys do it with that.
Oh, yes. You guys are good. All right, let's talk automotive fuel and what wonderful stuff that is for your opinion. Yeah. First of all, yes, it's a little cheaper, but you get less power. Does anyone know why you get less power? He gave a good clue.
The
ethanol. Oxygenate, to be more precise, whether it's ethanol or MTBF or whatever they want to call it. The whole deal with auto fuel is it's designed to burn slower. Why? Because they don't want to create so much nitrogen oxides pollution. Right? So they detune the fuel. So you put that fuel in an airplane engine, right? And same thing with a car engine, but you get to run an airplane engine full whack on the dyno and you can see what happens. That 1500 degree EGT that you saw earlier, that's running on standard Atkins. Wait till you see 1940 degrees EGT. That's what you get with car gas. Same engine, wide open throttle. Best power. Over 1900 degrees EGT. Because you got an exhausting flame front coming out of there.
Right.
And that gas is still burning on the way out. And here's the worst part, 5 horsepower less. And we're using more fuel. So is car gas really a good deal? Not really. Not really. No. Yes?
What about the freezing up of the fuel lines?
Well, that gets into the whole moisture problem, which is, again, the issues with car gas in general. You know, it's one thing to put it in your tank and drive it off every couple of days, but when it's sitting in your airplane for weeks on end or however long, and then, you know, it's collecting moisture and the whole rest of it. You know, the whole idea of freezing at altitude, by the way, we don't put antifreeze in the airplane because we keep messing with it. And that means I have to deal with the antifreeze, so we just run water in it. So everyone's asking, so what happens when you go up high? Well, I tell you, I took off from Camarillo one winter, and I climbed as high as I was legally allowed to climb, which is about 10,000 feet. Let's just say it was really cold up there for two reasons. I didn't have any cabin heat because I hadn't got that part of the system done yet. So trust me, it was cold. I don't know, it was minus freaking 45 or 50 up there. I had water in the system. Didn't freeze. I throttled back. Pretty much circled Camarillo and came down. Didn't freeze.
Water in what system? Fuel or?
No,
cooling system. Cooling system.
Yeah.
Pure water.
Yeah.
Pure water with an outside air temperature of minus 40 degrees. Didn't freeze. Because the engine's still running, it's still making power, it's still making heat. Now, okay. Is this a smart thing to do on a regular basis? No, I'm sure the radiator probably got a little slushy. You know, because, you know, while I was throttled back and going down, I'm pretty sure it got a little frozen. Yeah. But there was also enough going through it to keep it from getting totally frozen. Yes?
My concern isn't so much the cooling system being water, in my case, the whole resets that you use standard pump gas, car gas, as a result of the water cooling system. But that gets its own set of issues, like the fuel lines, and that's what I'm concerned about.
Well, remember, I only say car gas because it's one of the benefits. You don't have to run a high-octane fuel with a water-cooled engine. Doesn't mean you have to run car gas. I'm not advocating car gas, you know. In fact, we're designing the engine now to run on 92 plus octane. I think that's, we're always gonna have a 92 limit because we wanna be able to run a 92 pump gas. But that's just our design decision to give us enough margin so that in the future, if some poor guy stranded in who knows where Alaska decides to land on the highway and, hey, gas it up, you know, but his engine won't blow up if he goes flying off again. You know, that's why we're using the 92 number as a bottom octane for our design requirements. Yes?
We had a question. Since you were talking about not running the antifreeze in the system, what water quality are you looking at? Because I'll give you an example.
We can't, keep in mind, we're not running antifreeze in the system just for test purposes. It's the worst case scenario. There's no metallic protection in there, there's no antifreeze protection in there, and what we're trying to do is test the worst case scenario of how does the system age with none of the protection that antifreeze affords, which by the way, aside from keeping the water, lowering the freezing point of water, the main benefits of antifreeze are its protective qualities. It's chemical. They put an additive package in there to minimize all the corrosion kind of activities.
We used to get a aluminum oxide precipitant that came out because we were running DI and expensive.
Never, ever in anything with an aluminum block or radiator use an antifreeze with phosphorus in it. Ever. That includes the most prevalent antifreeze on the market, green Prestone in the yellow can. Put that in your cooling system, throw a radiator away, because it immediately generates aluminum sulfide, actually, that's what comes out of it. Precipitates aluminum sulfide, and it clogs the whole damn thing up. The spec that we go on is Dexcool, which is GM specification for cooling. And it basically, the decibel spec takes phosphorus out of the equation. Because they learned phosphorus and aluminum don't go together. So that's our only requirement on antifreeze. And you can use ethylene glycol or propylene glycol antifreeze, it doesn't matter.
How did you balance the flow so that each cylinder gets the same amount of water?
Very good question. You can see what we do is we run parallel flow. I mean, that may not have been obvious earlier. By the way, the average automotive engine runs serial flow, pumps water to the back of the engine usually, through the block, up, and then across the head and back to the front of the engine. So we're running serial flow, and to achieve the balance he's talking about, we have a restriction, water restrictor on the output of the cylinders, so that it creates a balance flow to run through them. And that's also what builds the pressure, because we have that water restrictor. There's actually, you'll see on the back, it's this little deck that's lifted into the back here, and that's where that water restrictor rests. Looks a lot like a washer. It's a calibrator. But I might add, that's what it started out being when we were dyno testing. So, you gotta start with something handy. That was a piece of metal we drilled a hole through and like put it in there, see how it works.
It's in parallel. They're all parallel, right?
Yes, we parallel feed. So every cylinder is running within 1 degree of the other. I mean, it's so close it isn't worth measuring. Which you won't even get that in a car engine. Because it's a serial cooler. Yes?
How does your radiator in your tank seal just idle now?
Another great question. Amazingly well. In fact, I was going to point out, you might have saw on that picture these four tabs. When we originally designed this, we thought, ground cooling, we're going to have to put a fan there. Well, that $100,000 tip I just gave you guys, what was it? 8 to 10 fins per inch. Well, you know that big fan on the front of the airplane? Turns out works really good. When you don't have a lot of pressure drop, air pressure drop across the radiator, air flows through it really easily, especially at low volume. It just wafts right through there. But I might add, not obvious, you'd think, well, the prop's doing all the work. It's blowing air in that hole, right? Not really. It's actually, and I wish I had a side view. It's actually sucking air out the back. That's what really does the job on the ground. That air volume moving past the prop disc underneath the cowling creates just enough suction. And oh, by the way, we got an instrument, and I know we pull a valve on the ground when we're idling. It's like anywhere between an eighth and a quarter inch of water of suction. It's remarkable just sitting there idling. Now, I've taken that airplane and parked it tail into the wind in a good 10 knot, 12 knot, tail into the wind and sat there and idled it until I was falling asleep. And then I thought, okay, well, I'm bored with that, let's rev it up. 1,000 RPM, 1,500 RPM, 2,000 RPM. Well, I better set the brake, 2,500 RPM. Screw it, full blast. And just sat there, tail with the wind. Being jumping around on the ramp and everything else, but you think it overheated? Nope. It went up maybe 5 degrees, so it was running at about 195 degrees or so, but that's well within spec. Our thermostat set at 190. Hotter, by the way, is better. That's just a whole other thing. Can't overheat it, and no fan required, which is really great. Now, the world's most difficult aircraft to cool is a long easy, or any basically pusher aircraft, right? Engine in the back, how do you keep that thing from melting? Well, turns out, it wasn't too difficult. Very quickly, this is the aircraft that flew to Oshkosh. Radiator's down the bottom, can't really see it. Big scoop. You know, the long easies, if you're familiar with them, the original design had this big old honking scoop on the belly of the cowling, and everyone tended to get rid of that and put a NACA instead because it was such a big, draggy installation and everything. The owner of the airplane had that NACAS coupon there for his air-cooled installation, and we tried a goofy setup. Well, no, he didn't actually have the NACAS. He was using the armpit scoops. He had the armpit scoops under the wings that brought air in and forced it through that way. And he was bringing air in and forcing it up and out in the air-cooled design. So we thought, well, we'll block the back. We'll bring the air in through the armpit scoops, and we'll put the radiator in the bottom and force the air through the radiator and out the bottom. Well, that turned out to be a terrible idea, because the air came in and hit the exhaust stacks, just picked up all the heat from the exhaust stack. So the inlet air into the radiator was 140 degrees. And this particular airplane was flying in Mojave in the summer, so it was a little challenging to keep it from overheating. We ultimately fixed this by the owner grumbling a lot and putting his scoop back on the bottom, because we said, you know what we want you to do is we want you to put that scoop on the bottom, that ugly big scoop that you can put a cat in because it's so huge, and force cold air into the radiator. The exit air from the radiator will simply scrub past and out the back. And he says, oh, it's going to be terrible. My airplane's going to go slow. Well, as it turns out, it actually went faster. 4 to 6 knots faster, and that is stunning for a longines, especially as one as efficient as this one was in its air-cooled configuration with the armpit scoops. 4 to 6 knots faster, better fuel economy. You know, look at the numbers. Not shabby.
At least because of better efficiency of the engine.
That was an IO 360, actually. That's an IO 360 that was an injected constant speed, the F1 A6 series engine. Yeah. No ground cooling problems in Mojave with 120 degree ramp temperatures. No electric fan assist required. And the reason why, same reason on the Cherokee. Just that prop creating suction from the outlet of the cowling was enough to draw enough air through the radiator when he was idling on the ramp. Even with his tail into the wind, it would not overheat.
What kind of engine did it have?
An IO360 F1A6, which the only real thing about that is it has a governor on the front of it near the prop side of the in his air engine back. Yes?
The gain of 4 to 6 knots, is that because of increased power?
Drag. Lower drag.
Less drag.
Less drag. You see that big scoop that he was so like, no, don't put that on my airplane. Because when it's air-cooled, there's 10 to 12 inches at the airspeeds he's flying at, 10 to 12 inches of pressure building up to force air through the engine. With our radiator in there, there was 3 to 4 inches of water, air pressure building up to push air through the radiator. What did I tell you about the plumbing, the big old pipe in the wind tunnel? There you go. That's it in a nutshell, especially an airplane that flies as fast as that. To get that level of airspeed gain is huge. No extra horsepower. I guarantee you, in fact, that thing made 182 horsepower on the dyno.
Just because of less drag internally, so it's faster
moving. It's less drag, less air pressure drag. That's what it's all about. So more air was going through that scoop than was just coming out of it all over the place and creating this huge turbulence behind the aircraft. Which, by the way, that huge turbulence goes right into the prop in a pusher.
Right.
So now you're affecting thrust efficiency, however you want to look at that. You got turbulent air going in the prop, not a good thing. So amazing what was achieved. The next gen cylinder, we already talked a little bit about this. We actually going to go as high as 12.5 to 1. We've increased intake flow up to 325, but actually that's an old number. It's not that high. It's a little lower, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. I'm trying to skip ahead a little bit. Believe it or not, it's patented.
Yeah, I think so.
Not so easily. This patent had to stand up against Daimler Benz's original patent for an internally liquid-cooled internal combustion engine.
Huh.
So I'm pretty pleased that we got it.
Was that 1898?
Yeah. There's a list of about 17 patents that this patent had to stand up against to be awarded. There are some pretty unique aspects of it, but one of the main things is it is patented as a conversion to an air-cooled engine. And a lot of conversions have been proffered as patentable, but as it turns out, the patent office thinks this one's pretty unique. And the cooling system analyzer, the same thing. There is actually no gauge like this on the market or anywhere that you're going to find to monitor a closed cooling system, whether it's for an internal combustion engine or any other thing. So the instrumentation is pretty unique as well. No, not certified yet. And maybe. We're not too crazy about putting it on the experimental market for two reasons. The worst thing that can happen is this goes into an experimental aircraft, and for whatever reason, that airplane has an accident. And the way things tend to go is if a new engine's involved in a wreck, even if it has nothing to do with the engine, maybe completely pilot error, controlled flight to cumulative granite. The risk we run is being completely derailed because the flying public's very good flying, but the pilot, the aircraft owners and pilots are very fickle. How many of us really want to fly in a Wheeler Express? See? But they fixed it. But by the time they fixed it, they kind of got a reputation of coming apart in the air. And nobody wants to find out if the one they're flying is going to come apart in the air. So the problem we got is the same thing with the engine. We want to get it certified, and we want to get it into at least a certified status so that we know that it passes the FAA blessing. Then it's going to be less likely to be like the finger pointing at it as, oh, this is what caused the thing to crash. Because everyone wants to jump on the new guy. So I guess that's the rest of it. So that's kind of in a nutshell, where we're standing on it. We'd like to get it certified. We're moving into this next gen design. Briefly, what derailed us was vendors going broke in the last few years. We lost our dyno shop. Believe it or not, it is very difficult to find a place that you can actually set an engine up, rev it up, and let it sit there for hour on end. There's plenty of dyno shops out there, but what they do is they run automotive engines on what's called torque run, and they're usually inertial dynos. They just got a big, huge wheel, and they rev the engine up, and they get the entire torque horsepower curve in one big rev, and then they let it idle back down, and they do it again. Can't do that with an airplane engine. I need to sit there and have it drone for a few hours. That's actually quite hard to do. So our shop that did our dyno work, partnership, they grew to hate each other, they closed up. The parts that you see here, I'm sad to say, are all boat anchors. They're all boat anchors. They don't even make the boat anchors, they're not very heavy. But this is a boat anchor. And this is a boat anchor because the intake port screwed up. And this has the same screwed up intake port on it, but we ran this. And we made these before we realized it was screwed up, and how that goes. So the shop that made these took a year to machine this casting. And we walked in the door with CNC programs and engineering proven from another machine shop. And the machine shop we were coming from was the second machine shop that made these heads. The first one went broke. Not because of us, the owner just mismanaged the shop and he's gone, and I remember getting called, hey Bob, you better come and get your stuff because the marshals are going to seize everything in the shop. Well, thanks, appreciate that. Second shop we move into, highly recommended, they're a gold vendor for ductless aircraft, they seem to know their stuff. Takes them a year, they turn a whole bunch of castings into crap. We salvage four of them. They couldn't drill a hole in the same place within 40 thousandths of an inch. You think, how is that possible in this thing? Well, it's really possible. It turns out their rotating table was a piece of crap. The shop foreman knew it, but the engineer working on our project was like, oh no, there's nothing wrong with that. We'll get it literally calibrated. So this is the kind of crap you go through to get something made. It's really, really hard. The last shop to make this, made these 4 years ago, and we all know what happened to the economy since then. And like I said, couldn't find a shop to dyno them. Came back to them this year, and last year, and said, hey, I'd like you to make some more parts for me. We fixed the intake port. And they said, oh, Bob, here, please bend over. Here's the shaft. This is how much we want to make your parts. I have to find another vendor because it was ridiculous. They wanted $1,000 a unit to machine it. $350 a casting. Doesn't work. So, see the problem. You know, it's just the way the world turns. It's very, very hard to actually get parts made. And in the GA world, I think you guys should know, there are more engines made for the Formula One race cars in the world every year than there are engines built for general aviation.
What?
Yes. GA isn't just small, it takes, it's a cottage industry at best. This needs to change. I tell you guys, it needs to change. Because it's going to be very difficult even for stubborn people like me to push something like this through. You know, I'm still moving ahead. I found a dyno down in Orange County. Well, we're in Orange County, so I used to come the other way. But anyway, I found a dyno shop that has a small, much smaller dyno than we used to have, but you can probably hold about 400 horse on it. And it's a water break dyno, which means we can run for a while, but he doesn't have any cooling, so the most we're going to be able to run is probably 20, 30 minutes before we overheat his dyno. You know? But at least I'll be able to get some horsepower readings and stuff like that. But will we get a lot of the other data we want? Like we want fuel efficiency, air mass, and oxygen, and all this other good stuff that we can get from any well-instrumented dyno. We're not going to get that at that time. You know?
So how many aircraft did or yeah. Six cylinder horizontally
closed are manufactured? I couldn't tell you how many six cylinders are made. I can just tell you that generally speaking, there's the total number of produced aircraft engines by Lycoming and Continental combined is less numerically than all of the Formula One engines that are produced worldwide for the Formula One, Indy, all that kind of open wheel car racing. That's how small GA is. And those engines are typically $100,000 a piece. So, you know.
What's your estimated cost of a conversion?
For four banger right now, the target we were shooting for, just to convert the engine, was roughly $2,000 a cylinder plus instrumentation and everything else. So probably looking at total conversion cost around $18,000.
After you come to the table with the Lycoming.
Yeah, that's assuming you have a bottom end that's already rebuilt. So, this is just the top end stuff. So, in our case, pistons out. Because we'd be supplying pistons and rings and everything else. Instrumentation. So, $18,000 right there. Doesn't include radiator. Doesn't include a cowl. And you will need both. And you will not be able to use an automotive radiator. Don't even think about using an automotive radiator. Anything with a hose clamp? And not only that, but automotive radiator guys, they're designed to run at 20 miles an hour. 25, actually, I think is their peak airspeed efficiency. So that's why they're finned at 18 to 22 fins per inch. And they're big, because you're usually stuck in traffic with your air conditioning on.
Low airflow.
Yeah, exactly, low airflow. It's like running a flat plate through the air. You don't want to put that in an aircraft. And I hear all the stories of all the guys that are trying to jam car radiators in their airplanes, and it's like, no, not gonna work, you know.
So you go to this special.
I got $100,000 spent on it to prove it.
You specify the radiator, but somebody builds it for you.
Yes, yes. I have a Griffin radiator in South Carolina. I'd recommend them. They do a very good job. And that's another interesting problem. See, there's three, maybe four companies left in the United States that actually make radiator cores. Only one will make a radiator core if you want less than 1,000 of them. And if Griffin decides to stop doing it, there is nobody else in this country. So this is problematic, I mean, even for my project, you know? So, cost for the typical radiator from Griffith is between $3,000 and $4,000 for those radiators that you've seen so far. That's just the cost to produce it, not including all the engineering time and everything else. So, yes?
I learned at the GNR show, that there's such limited engines to build for distance.
if I understand correctly, you're saying those are adiabatic engines. They're not water cooled. They're not air cooled. They're turbine. There's no cooling system per se in a turbine aircraft engine other than water cooler at the most.
The only reason I'm asking is because now some of the F-16's F-110 engine, the GF-110 air cooled, versus the F-22's engine is liquid cooled. I never heard that.
Yeah, okay. If it sounds like a vacuum cleaner, it is air cooled or adiabatic, depending on how you want it. It sucks it in one end, heats it up, blows it out the other end. Yes.
Didn't you make a presentation once about Chapter 7, EAA Chapter 7, where you landed on the freeway? Is that the same?
I knew somebody in this audience would remember that. yes, I will remember that.
In your days.
But I will say this. That's a subject for a completely different presentation. If you guys are interested in it, I'd be more than happy to go into that. There's several elements of that that I think you would find interesting, not just on the nature of the failure that got me there, but also the entire experience.
Yeah, I remember some of it, but
But suffice it to say that aside from me being the, you know, CEO, chief pilot, you know, chief cook and bottle washer, I unfortunately was in a position where, I had to put it down on the road. And what I will say in summary is, again, a lot of care and effort's been taken into building this system. I used to work at Douglas Aircraft and Quality Assurance. I got to know a lot of the vendors that Douglas used to test materials and stuff that went into the jet aircraft that they were building there. I used a facility here in LA, a certified test facility that does destructive testing on materials to test the steel that we were going to use in making some parts. And all it took was some hourly employee who was just feeling lazy that day to pencil whip my test report. And that almost killed me. And don't think it didn't happen just to me. Piper Aircraft was affected by the same employee on different steel that was passed through that same shop, because a lot of aircraft manufacturers use them. You pencil with the report on the seatbelt steel attachment points, and the same pieces of metal that are used, same pieces of steel that are used for the buttresses on the spar, fore and aft spars in a Piper aircraft, and they pencil with the reports on that. Cost Piper a few $1 million to go back and fix those airplanes. The problem was discovered by an assembly line employee when they saw something bent that shouldn't have been bent. Thankfully, no airplanes came apart, but in my case, I suffered a cylinder failure.
So we invite you back for that presentation?
If you would like, yes. And I will come clean. I mean, in the end, this is engine development, and it's not easy. And I got to tell you that it really pissed me off to have something that simple almost kill me and almost kill the program. So it's amazing how hard it can be to get this kind of stuff done. You know? So. Yes.
I know how tough it is to kind of guesstimate when you think you can be able to have a production product, but it sounds like you're in a rush against time with the EPA one pull the plug on lead and get all that stuff out of the aviation industry.
I think it'd be wonderful if lead disappeared tomorrow, because then you'd be peace.
You'd be forced to be.
Because the problem here is air-cooled engines, exactly. And we already know this in the business. People that I know who have tested air-cooled engines in dyno facilities to see how long they'll last on unleaded fuel, ready? Normally aspirated, if you're lucky, $500. Turbocharged, $200 to $300. And here's what happens. The failure is either micro-welding of the valve face to the seat, and the moment that occurs, the valve is closed properly. In seconds, it burns. Exhaust valve gone, you know what comes next. In the case of diffusion, which is where the seat basically gets pounded to death and effectively the steel just evaporates from the seat because it's being slammed so hard and hot, the seat slowly descends and it takes the lash up in the hydraulic lifter to the point where, again, the valve doesn't close properly. As soon as that happens, burn the valve. So the micro welding tended to happen more with the turbocharged engines because, for obvious reasons, they're running a hell of a lot hotter. And the diffusion failures typically with the air cooled, with the normally aspirated motors. Bottom line is, you're going to go from 2,000 hour TDOs, probably closer to 500 hours. Now, there are going to be those people who argue, but I know people that run unleaded fuel in their engine all the time, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, one tank with unleaded, one tank with avgas. Or periodically introducing avgas into the system. So you're replenishing the lead occasionally. Mm-hmm. It's helping. A lot of these engines tend to be low power, too, 320. People tend to fly, you know, the less power you use, the less it's going to wear. But I'm talking, these are hard running tests. These are running the engines at 70-80% power for several hundred hours, and they've gone. Does it mean that every engine's going to die at 500 hours? No. You might get 800 or 900 hours, but eventually it's going to go. It's going to go way short of 2,000 hours that Lycoming and Continental claim it can be done. And no, there's no magic chemical out there. Right now, the big problem, the whole reason they keep going on about, oh, what are we going to do? Look, you can get 100-octane avgas. You can 100-octane race gas and 110-octane race gas today. Not a problem. And it doesn't have ethanol in it either. It's good stuff. Works great in airplanes. But it has no lead at all. And this is the whole problem. And this whole discussion you're hearing, what they're really not saying between the lines is, we're looking for the magic chemical which will reestablish that dissimilar insulation between the exhaust phase and the seat. And I don't know, I'm not a chemist, but my thinking is that's a piece of alchemy that nobody can figure out.
And that's just required in an air-cooled engine.
Yep. So basically, unleaded fuel to me obsoletes all air-cooled engines pretty much overnight, or unless you want to spend a lot of money on them to keep them running. So I'd love it if that happened. This might get interesting. You know, somebody might actually come knock on my door and go, hey, Bob, looks like a pretty good idea. So
thank you so very much. One of the finest technical talks I've ever heard. I think we covered metallurgy, fluid dynamics, aerodynamics, you name it. It's a very, very awesome field, very impressive, and we thank you very much.
Thank you.